At this time, all participants are in listen-only mode. Later, we'll conduct a question-and-answer session, and instructions will be given at that time. If you should require assistance during the call, you may press star, then zero, and an operator will assist you offline. I would now like to turn the conference over to our host, Dr. Muntu Davis. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and good afternoon, everyone. Today, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about our progress in slowing the spread of COVID-19 that we appear to be making in LA County. While this is very good news, I want to also encourage all of us to learn from our recent history during the pandemic, so that as we approach new stages of recovery, we don't experience the spike in cases, hospitalizations, and tragically deaths that we all saw in July. So today, I'm going to show you trend lines of our key indicators from the beginning of June through the past week. As a reminder of what we can do when we do everything that we need to in terms of controlling the spread. So we'll go to slide one first, please. This slide shows the daily reported number of COVID-19 cases since June 1st. When we began the month in June, we were seeing around 1,300 cases per day, and this was due in large part to a reduction in opportunities for people to be exposed from mid-March to the late May, with businesses and non-essential services being closed and people wearing cloth face coverings and practicing physical distancing when outside their homes. As more businesses began to reopen in late May and June, people were out of their homes, not all were careful about wearing face coverings, and not keeping their distance. And we did see a number of businesses that were not complying with the infection control practices that are so important in preventing infections and slowing the spread of this virus. Just a few weeks later, in late June, we began to see an increase in cases, and then seeing an alarming spike around 3,200 cases per day in mid to late July. Let's go to the next slide. As we've reported often throughout this pandemic, the daily number of reported cases is not always the best measure of understanding our progress. The number is dependent upon the amount of testing that is happening, and there are sometimes backlogs in reporting by the labs and the state. Another important indicator is the percentage of positive test results. This slide shows the percentage of positive test results from June through last week. While our case numbers were spiking in July, we also saw a rapid increase in the percent of tests that were positive. In early June, we were seeing between 5% and 6% of tests resulting in a positive. But starting in late June and through the month of July, we saw this rate increase to between 8% and 9%. Since closing some indoor businesses and activities, and with improved compliance among the majority of businesses that were open, we saw this rate return to the levels we saw in early June. Let's go to the next slide. When we see an increased number of cases, unfortunately, we know that we will begin to see an increase in people becoming seriously ill and requiring hospitalization. And in early July, this is just what we saw. In early June, the three-day average of daily hospitalizations for COVID-19 were around 1,400, and on July 19th, this number spiked to over 2,000. Fortunately, with reclosing and improved compliance, this number also returned to early June levels. On August 21st, the three-day average number of people being currently hospitalized for COVID-19 was 1,291. Let's go to the next slide. As we saw more people beginning to become seriously ill with the virus in mid-July, unfortunately, the seven-day average of people passing away from COVID-19 increased as well. Spiking in late July, an average of 44 deaths per day were noted. While no number of deaths is acceptable, we are seeing this number go in the right direction. On August 16th, the average number of deaths reported each day has returned to that of 2 months ago at 28. As we're moving forwards with improvement on all of our recovery metrics, what does this mean for Los Angeles County? First, it means, thankfully, that the work we have all done as a community and the sacrifices we are making are working. We're preventing COVID-19 infections, including serious illness and deaths. Second, if we can maintain this lower transmission, it means that we could begin to think about schools and more businesses reopening, or someday moving their operations back indoors. But what I'd like to stress is the importance of all of us learning from our recent past and the spikes in cases. hospitalizations, as well as deaths in our community that we experienced in July. As we continue our journey of recovery, we must all proceed with caution. All of us must own our roles in this recovery. For businesses, this means following all of the requirements outlined in the health officer orders. These requirements are in place to protect you, your employees, and your customers. It also means alerting us if your business may have an outbreak with three or more cases within 14 days. And you do this so we can help you take actions that may prevent more cases in terms of people becoming ill inside of your workplace, which could also help slow the spread of the virus in our communities. For individuals, this means using the only tools we have to slow the spread. It means not planning or attending gatherings with people outside your household. It means correctly wearing your cloth face coverings over both your nose and your mouth, and keeping physical distance when you're out of your home and around other people. It also means isolating and quarantining if you are infected with COVID-19 or have been in close contact with someone who is infected with COVID-19. Together, we must all take our roles seriously and be diligent. It is everyone's goals to get to a place where we have a safer reopening. But community transmission rates must continue to decrease if we are to get to this place, including where schools can reopen in a way that is safer for students, teachers, and staff members. Cautious reopening doesn't mean that everything will go back to normal, and we will return to the way it was before COVID-19. Cautious reopening means that we take to heart the lessons we've learned from July and move forward in a new normal of making the infection control practices part of our day-to-day lives for the foreseeable future. We are saving lives and for our loved ones and friends and our neighbors when we do this. And now I'd like to give you an update on our current status. To update you on our daily status, we're sad to report an additional 13 deaths today. 9 of these people who died are over the age of 80, and 8 people who passed away had underlying health conditions. 2 of these people who died are between the ages of 65 and 79, and 1 person who passed away had underlying health conditions. 1 person who died is between the ages of 50 and 64, and this person had underlying health conditions. 1 of the people who died is between the ages of 30 and 49, and this person also had underlying health conditions. This unfortunately brings our total number of deaths to 5,558 in Los Angeles County. Our deepest sympathies go out to everyone who has lost a loved one or a friend to COVID-19. 92% of the persons who died from COVID-19 had underlying health conditions, but this also means that 8% of the people who died were healthy. For the 5,231 people who have passed away from where we know race and ethnicity, 50% were Latino, Latina, or Latinx, 24% are white, 15% are Asian, and 10% are Black, and less than 1% are Native Hawaiian or Pacific Islander, and 1% identified with another race or ethnicity. We're reporting 1,198 deaths today. This brings our total cases in LA County to 232,893. These cases include 10,111 cases reported by our partners in the city of Long Beach and 2,291 cases reported by the city of Pasadena, which have independent city health departments. We're reporting 1,498 confirmed cases among people experiencing homelessness. Among these cases, 422 were referred to isolation and quarantine sites to appropriately isolate for the duration of their illness. 1,219 confirmed cases are currently hospitalized. 32% of these people are confirmed cases in the ICU, and 18% are on ventilators. We've investigated a total of 1,542 residential congregate settings and non-residential settings with at least 1 confirmed case of COVID-19. Of these, 875 are being currently investigated, and 667 are closed investigations. Residential settings include nursing homes, assisted living facilities, shelters, treatment centers, supported living, and correctional facilities. Non-residential settings include workplaces, food and retail, and educational settings. The confirmed cases in institutional settings is 31,096, including both staff and residents. 15,980 of these confirmed cases are residents, and 15,116 are staff. We're sad to report that 2,502 residents in institutional settings have died from COVID-19. 2,266 of these people who died in institutional settings resided in skilled nursing facilities. Of 13 newly reported deaths today, excluding Long Beach and Pasadena, 3, or 23%, were skilled nursing facility associated deaths. We know so many across the county are experiencing profound grief, and we are sorry for your loss. We're reporting 3,535 confirmed cases at some point in jail facilities, 3,140 among people who are incarcerated, and 395 among staff. The Sheriff's Office is reporting for their facilities 14 inmates who are positive, and 47 inmates are in isolation, and 1,433 are quarantined. There are 229 in the state prison, 169 among people who are incarcerated, and 60 among staff, and 758 cases in federal prisons facilities, 742 among people who are incarcerated, and 16 among staff. And 138 in the juvenile facilities, and 53 among youth, and 79 among staff. Almost 2.2 billion people who have tested positive for COVID-19 have been positive, and it means about 10% of them have been positive. I want to close by recognizing all that we continue to experience as a community going through this pandemic. This has been an extraordinarily difficult time. So many have lost loved ones and friends. People across the county have lost jobs, businesses have had to close, healthcare workers continue to do their job every day with incredible bravery and skill. Parents and children are navigating so much in terms of returning to school with distance learning. This understandably takes a toll, and I want to remind all of you that if you're stressed and worried, you're not alone, and help is available. There are crisis and emotional wellness resources at the Department of Mental Health Helpline, which is 1-800-854-7711. Again, that's 800-854-7771. And if you are in crisis or you know someone who is in crisis, you can call the Suicide Prevention Line at 800-273-8255. Again, that's 800-273-8255. You can call that line to talk with a caring and trained counselor. It's free, it's confidential, and it's 24 hours a day and 7 days a week. I encourage you to reach out to resources for help. And I want to remind you that what we're seeing, we are seeing improvement, and if this continues, we can continue our recovery journey to get back to closer to the way that we were before. And I'll open it up to questions.
And our first question, ladies and gentlemen, if you do wish to ask a question over the call, you may press 1 and 0. If you're using a speakerphone, please pick up the handset before pressing any of the numbers. Our first question comes from the line of Colin Shelby with LA Times. Please go ahead.
Hi, thanks for taking my question. I'm just wondering, given the fact that some of those spikes that you had mentioned occurred over holiday weekends, Memorial Day, 4th of July, if there's any additional concern right now that since Labor Day is coming up in 2 weeks, if we could be seeing another spike given with activity around that coming holiday weekend.
Yeah, thank you very much for that question. And, you know, it's always a concern if there are going to be opportunities that people are going to be around, you know, others who are not part of their household. It's an active discussion in terms of, you know, what we want to do with that, including talking to our city mayors who have beaches as well as our board members. So it's an active discussion, but we'll make that call as we finish those discussions. Next question.
Our next question comes to the line of Claudia Pescuda with KNX News Radio. Please go ahead.
Hi. Do you have the number of homeless deaths and with the total cases among homeless people, do you think that's an accurate representation of what's happening on the streets, you know, given the difficulties that would be involved in contact tracing and just getting people tested? Thank you.
Thank you, Claudia. I think the numbers that we have are the best estimate that we have. I'm sure that there may be, again, even among our general population, cases that are being missed that aren't being tested and aren't coming to our attention. But in general, it is fairly good, and we understand that, you know, again, we may be missing some things, but in general, we think we're catching as much as we can at this moment. And I do want to give a lot of credit to everyone who is working with people experiencing homelessness and all of the work that they've been doing to, one, get people tested and identified that may be at risk, as well as caring for them in their shelters or in the isolation and quarantine sites. So a lot of credit goes to them for implementing the measures that are needed. Thank you. We'll take one more question.
Our next question comes to the line of Ryan Carter with LA Daily News. Please go ahead.
Hey, excuse me. Thank you, Doctor. So I think you touched on this a little bit in the thrust of your words today, but I wanted to dig down a little bit more on just sort of the monitoring list and the possibilities of getting off that list. How close are we, do you think? Do you know? And if you could elaborate a little bit more on why you think we are getting close in the first place. I don't know if there are any elected leaders here on the call, but I guess I wondered about lessons learned from the first easing of restrictions and how concerned either you as the public health officer are, or these leaders are concerned about pushing too hard to reopen, given the push that happened in the last go around. Thank you.
Yeah, and I appreciate the question. I think in general, you know, we're learning a lot. We've seen, you know, more businesses that early on weren't in compliance with the orders, and all of them coming into compliance, or the majority of them coming into compliance, has been helpful. So I think as people, both businesses and the community, are looking at this, we're seeing, you know, more and more people, you know, doing what's needed, and that is actually what's helping to slow the spread of this. And those measures will continue to need to be in place even as things reopen, in terms of maintaining your face covering or keeping your distance and keeping your distance from others, you know, more than 6 feet. And so I think as we are seeing this and as more people are getting used to these measures being in place, it may change how we look at and what happens when we reopen. It is always a concern, but I think, you know, as people have gone through this and been going for this for months now, and again, lots of hard sacrifices in this, there are some lessons learned, and again, that's what we're highlighting today, that these measures do work, and even as things start to reopen, those businesses that are able to reopen or move their operations indoors still need to adhere to those recommendations that are required inside of the health officer order. So I think, you know, as we go through this, you know, it's been a lessons learned, and I think more people are getting it and adhering to it, and that has been helpful, and that's what we do as a community, everybody doing their part and following what the recommendations are for their group. So thank you. I appreciate the questions, and now we'll turn it over to remarks in Spanish.